Today is Thursday, 17th October, and we still have not had, as at the moment, time of making of this programme, news of an Israeli strike on Iran. Fighting between Israel and Hezbollah in southern Lebanon continues. Fighting between Israel and Hamas in Gaza continues also. There are reports of a Hezbollah rocket attack on Israel. I don't know many details. And the Times of India, Times of Israel, is reporting that the United States has conducted an airstrike on Houthi positions in Yemen using a B-2 stealth bomber. Now, I've not seen this reported anywhere else, but I have to say, if it's true, then it seems to be colossal overkill, using an incredibly expensive, incredibly sophisticated bomber of this kind to conduct an airstrike on a target in Yemen, which has, I suspect, only a embryonic air defense system. As I said, it seems completely, completely disproportionate in terms of the needs that such an airstrike would require. Now, the Times of Israel, along with all the other Israeli media, are incredibly interesting in discussing the various opinions and debates that take place in Israel. In fact, they're indispensable reading if one wants to understand the political conflicts in Israel itself. I've noticed that they are not completely and 100% reliable in reporting particular events on the ground. That is completely unsurprising. One should not expect it, but to a degree that perhaps one might prefer was not the case, they do reproduce rumours and stories which, as it turns out later, are not always completely reliable or entirely true. And I have to say, I haven't seen anywhere else any report of an attack on a Houthi position in Yemen by the United States using a B-2 stealth bomber. So perhaps this is just a story that we should file away and say to ourselves, well, maybe it's true, maybe it's not. Maybe the Times of Israel is basing this more on speculation and rumour and gossip rather than any accurate report. However, the Times of Israel does go on to say that the reason the strike was carried out on the Houthis using a B-2 bomber was because it was intended not so much to damage the Houthis, but rather as a signal to Iran. In other words, that the United States has deployed or has the ability to deploy powerful stealth bombers like the B-2 bomber to the region and can use them to conduct strikes, presumably on Iranian targets. Now, if this is correct, then I would suggest that this is a very ominous piece of information. It is evidence that the United States has assets in the region and is signalling to Iran that it is prepared to join in an Israeli strike against Iran if the situation in the conflict area reaches that point when an American escalation of that kind, in the judgment of the administration in the United States, becomes appropriate. So that brings us closer, ever closer to that point where the United States becomes directly involved in a conflict in the Middle East between Iran and Israel. Now, Larry Johnson, amongst others, but specifically Larry Johnson on Sonar 21, has also spoken about the deployment of the THAAD missile interceptors to Israel. as being intended less as an act to bolster what looked like Israel's already leaky and perhaps somewhat threadbare air defenses. The Israelis have launched many, many air defense missiles over the last year, and the Financial Times strongly suggests that they're running short, even as they're preparing to take on the power of Iran. Anyway, Larry Johnson basically made the point that the American presence, the military presence in Israel, the fact that there are American boots on the ground in Israel, even if only 100 men operating this THAAD missile complex, that this is a sign that we are, that the United States is positioning assets in the region, and that these American troops are intended as some kind of a tripwire, and in itself as a sort of warning to Iran of American resolve and American readiness to take military action alongside Israel against Iran, if, as I said, the administration decides that that is what should happen. And frankly, it looks to me as if this airstrike with a B-2 bomber on the Houthis is intended as another signal to Iran that, as I said, the United States is prepared to act in that sort of way. Now, this is a very dangerous game. If the Israelis launch their strike over the next couple of hours or days, and I should say that I read somewhere, I forget where, but I read somewhere, I think it was in the Israeli media yesterday, that as of late yesterday, the Israeli strikes, the preparations for the Israeli strike on Iran have been completed, that the Israelis now are ready to conduct the strike so that it is likely to be launched at any moment, perhaps will have been launched by the time you're watching this video. Well, the Iranians have again been signaling, again, you only need to go to the Iranian media to see that, that if there is a strike against them by Israel, then they will respond. And of course, they're saying that such a response will be more powerful still than the Iranian missile strike on Israel of the 1st of October, in which case we could very well find ourselves in that situation that the United States, through these various moves, the deployment of the THAAD missile interceptors to Israel, this possible attack by a B-2 bomber on the Houthis, well, we could find ourselves in precisely that situation where the United States finds itself having either to act on its warnings to Iran or to lose face in what could be a catastrophic way in this difficult region, the Middle East. So anyway, we are in a complex game, complex poker game, in which there are a bewildering number of players, the Iranians, the Americans, the Israelis, the Russians, the Gulf states. They're all playing poker with each other, Hezbollah too, Hamas as well. And it's a poker game in which, as far as I can see, there is a huge amount of bluff and great uncertainty on each side as to the strength of the cards each is playing, has to play, and where there are no clear rules either establishing the framework of the game. And where, lastly, and as I've said many times, there are some people in Israel, people like Ben-Gvir, people like Smotrich, people like in my opinion, Prime Minister Netanyahu, who are clearly seeking a war, some kind of escalation. In the case of Ben-Gvir, as I said in my program yesterday, he's now giving interviews to Israeli army radio in which he says that we must seize this opportunity to cut off the head of the snake. Now, I had a lot more information over the last couple of hours, specifically from one particular invaluably useful source, discussing further the Iranian air defense system. As I said, it's not an entirely straightforward picture because it's a system that the Iranians have created. It looks to be either based on or philosophically very close to what we know about the Russian air defense system, just to say. And of course, the Iranians actually have Russian air defense missiles, S-300 missiles, definitely on their territory. Seymour Hersh, in a recent article, in which he also cast doubt on claims that Iran is moving forward at this present time to acquiring nuclear weapons capability. Anyway, he reported, presumably based on his sources, that what has actually happened over the last few weeks is that the Russians have upgraded the S-300 system that has already been deployed to Iran. Now, here I ought to explain something about the S-300, which I've touched on before in various programs talking about it, the S-300 in the conflict in Ukraine, which is that the S-300 system is not a single missile. It is a family of many different missiles and many different radars and associated pieces of equipment, some of them reaching all the way back to the to 1980, when the first part, the first elements that made up this family were first deployed. Those systems would be considered somewhat outdated by today's standards. But lots of different missiles have been produced at various times. Some long range, some short range, some intended to shoot down missiles, other missiles primarily intended to shoot down missiles, some tasked with shooting down cruise missiles, others more focused on shooting down aircraft. There's all kinds of radars that have been developed, again, at different times, some of them very modern, some of them less modern. There's constant integration of different packages, and the system appears to have been designed from the outset so that it could be enhanced and evolved and developed in precisely this sort of way. The S-400 that we hear so much about is, in effect, an organic evolution of this family of missiles. In fact, I understand that when first proposed, it was intended, it was going to be designated as simply another member of this immense S-300 family. So when we talk about S-300 system deployed in Iran, it's entirely possible that the Russians have been quietly replacing less sophisticated, less advanced, less modern S-300 missiles previously deployed to Iran with more modern ones, that they have provided more sophisticated radars and command and control systems, and that this body of missiles has been expanded significantly as well and might be covering more sites, and that this might have been happening since the summer. Just saying. And that might explain some of those American reports that we were hearing about back in the summer. Anyway, the Iranians also have developed their own systems, which, as I said, have a certain similarity to the Russian systems. And the Iranians have also apparently, according to this correspondent, who, as I said, definitely knows what he's talking about. He's somebody who, this is entirely his field, just to make that absolutely clear. Anyway, this person has pointed out that a lot of these systems that the Iranians have developed are in some way an point defense systems. They're relatively short range. They are therefore analogs in some cases, not in all cases. The Iranians have also developed some more long range and powerful missiles. But a lot of the systems that the Iranians have developed and deployed are more analogous to Russian systems like the Tor and the Pantsir than they are to systems like the S-300. The Iranians have their S-300 analogs, but they have focused more on developing systems like the Pantsir and the Tor. And in fact, to my knowledge, Iran actually operates the Russian Tor system. The Russians actually exported some Tor systems to Iran. And in fact, one of these systems accidentally shot down a Ukrainian civil airliner about a year ago, as I remember, and I'm sure many people also remember. So the Iranians do have an air defense system. I should say that these systems, these Iranian point defense systems, are analogous to the Russian Tor and Pantsir system. They are not identical to those systems or even similar to them. It seems rather that they fulfill a similar role. And that is what one would expect, that the Iranians, in order to protect their key sites, would focus principally on point defense systems, as opposed to trying to establish kind of comprehensive coverage over their enormous and very complex country. In time, they probably would want to develop the kind of system that the Russians have, where huge stretches of territory can be covered by layered air defenses. I'm not saying that the Iranians don't try to do that in some places. But anyway, they can't obviously do it on the same scale as the Russians do, because their resources are not as great, but that they will have focused principally on point defense systems. And of course, that poses a number of questions, because it may mean, for example, that the Iranians might have less of an ability to shoot down stealth fighters and stealth bombers, but might be more successful in destroying the missiles that these bombers launch. That's just my own thought. I may be completely wrong there. They do, as I said, have long-range systems, but I suspect it will also partly depend on how many S-300s and how sophisticated the S-300s they have received that the Russians have provided. Anyway, we will see. So this is a complex story, and I wonder to what extent the Americans and the Israelis know fully, precisely, the nature of the air defense system that they're taking on. Now, I've also received more information about the alleged Iranian nuclear test, underground nuclear test. It is extremely interesting. I'm very grateful to the person who has provided it. I should say again, this is very much this person's area of expertise. I know what he says about the fact that the evidence does perhaps point to such a test having taken place. I'm going to wait for more information from open sources before I jump to that kind of conclusion. I still find it strange that if we had had an Iranian nuclear test, the United States, which certainly would know about it, would not have mentioned the fact. Anyway, there we are. Let's wait and see. Let's wait and see what happens. But anyway, all of the moves, all of the positioning of the pieces continues to take place, and we could be very soon now going to have this Israeli strike on Iran. Now, there is something else I wanted to just touch on, which is that the European Union and the countries that make up the Gulf Cooperation Council, basically the Arab Gulf countries, the Arab Gulf monarchies, have had a meeting. This is one of the regular meetings that they have had. The Europeans apparently insisted that the final statement includes certain comments about Iran, again pressing Iran to conduct de-escalation. The Iranians were not happy with the fact that the Arab states, the Gulf states, went along with this statement and have made that fact public. Though I have to say that the language of the statement does not seem to me to be as aggressively hostile to Iran as statements that the Americans and the Europeans, when they've called for de-escalation, has been. The Arab states continue, in other words, to try to stay on this extremely, to keep going on this extremely difficult balancing act, where they don't take decisive sides either for or against Iran. I wonder how long that can continue if we do find ourselves in an all-out war. Just saying. And again, those who want the Arab states to basically make common cause with the United States and Israel, I would suggest that they need to be very careful about that. They need to be careful what they wish for. If the Arab states find themselves lining up with Israel and the United States in the context of an all-out war between the Iranians and the Israelis, with the United States involved on one side, and no doubt the Russians in particular, making their own moves on the other, then of course oil installations across the Middle East suddenly might find themselves at risk. So I'm not saying that will necessarily happen. So just say this is a possibility which, in light of what happened with the Iranian missile strike of the 1st of October, we cannot disregard or discount. I think the Arabs themselves are very, very conscious of these risks, and all the indications are that they're pleading with the Israelis, but specifically with the Americans, to exercise restraint, even as they find themselves pushed to make statements calling for Iran to do the same. Anyway, there we are. That's it. That's all I can tell you today, as of now, about the situation in the Middle East. I do regard reports of use of a B-2 stealth bomber for an airstrike against the Houthis as concerning. I'm not completely convinced that this report is necessarily true. If it is true, well, I think in that case we have multiple causes for very real concern. Anyway, that's all I'm going to say about the situation in the Middle East as of now. Let's turn to that other conflict, and let's turn to the situation in Ukraine. And I'm going to start with the speech, again, the speech that President Zelensky made to the Ukrainian parliament yesterday. I've now read the complete text of the speech. I've also listened to a broadcast, a film. I've watched a film of Zelensky making the speech, but you can find the official text of the speech on Zelensky's website, President of Ukraine. It's all there. And the title is, "May our collective work under the victory plan result in peace for Ukraine as soon as possible." Speech by the president in the Verkhovna Rada. And as I said, you have the whole full text of Zelensky's speech there. And I'm going to say straight away that I've noticed a very strange thing about the speech that Zelensky has given, which is that the Western media, at least the British media, has almost entirely ignored it. I'm not saying that they've not mentioned it at all, but given that this is the speech where Zelensky was outlining his victory plan and the nature of the demands that he was making of the Western powers and the attention his every word used to be given once upon a time, and the way in which he was built up to heroic status by the media in the West at one time, and given the enormous importance that the Ukraine conflict has been accorded by the media in the West, and the enormous amount of attention it has formerly received, I find the lack of coverage of this speech really, truly remarkable. It is extraordinary. Now, I can only conclude from that that the West, the media, but also Western governments, who are clearly communicating at multiple levels their feelings about this speech to the media, that Western governments are extremely embarrassed by this speech. They're embarrassed by the nature of the demands that Zelensky is making of them. And they're probably also embarrassed by the tone and language that he used over the course of the speech itself. And that the media, therefore, has been given a gentle steer to draw down the curtain of charity, if you like, or of silence over the affair. One absolutely correct point that has been made about this speech has again been made by Julian Repke, the Ukraine correspondent of the German tabloid Bild Zeitung. He has absolutely rightly said, he says, by the way, that the speech left him speechless. He absolutely rightly said that the speech provides no military plan for action. It doesn't outline what the Ukrainian military must or should do over the next couple of weeks or months to retrieve the situation, to stabilize the situation, to create a proper defense system, to hold back the Russians. It doesn't do any of that. What it does instead is set out a list of demands, all of which the Western powers have already previously rejected. It sets out one proposal after another for immediate, for accelerated NATO membership, for huge military deployments in Ukraine, for deep missile strikes against Russia, all of those things, things which Western governments have already said up to now that they will not do. And that is absolutely correct. Now, there is a case that can be made that Zelensky, it's understandable why Zelensky is not taking no for an answer with respect to all of these things. After all, the story of the Ukraine conflict right from the start of the special military operation in February 2022 is of the Western powers appearing to rule out supplies of all sorts of weaponry to Ukraine. They started by saying armored vehicles won't be provided. Artillery will not be provided. Long-range missiles like the HIMARS will not be provided. Then missiles like air-launched cruise missiles, long-range cruise missiles like the ATACMS under Storm Shadow will not be provided. Fighter jets will not be provided. Tanks will not be provided. All of them at various times have been provided to Ukraine. Ukraine has received weapons from the West, which the West has repeatedly said it would not give. There have been endless numbers of times when the West has drawn its own red lines, saying what it will give Ukraine and what it won't, and then always and invariably, it has crossed those red lines. And then, of course, there's been the pretense that those red lines were Russian red lines. I've pointed out many times that that was not ever the case, but they have been Western red lines. The Western powers have always and consistently said, no, they won't do these things, and then they've gone ahead and done them. So it is perhaps understandable that Zelensky saying to himself, well, they've said no before, and I haven't taken no for an answer, and I've gone on asking for the same thing, and no has eventually become yes, so let me do that all over again. Let me go on repeating my demands as I have done in the past, and this time again, the West will eventually relent and give me all of those things that I'm asking for. Well, that could be true, but I am going to suggest that this time, it may be different. And this is less to do with the current military situation in Ukraine or the political situation in Washington. It has a certain amount to do with the depletion of Ukrainian military, American and European military arsenals. But it has a lot to do with something else, and an article in Politico has touched on this, which is that what Zelensky is now demanding is different from before. Because before, Zelensky was asking the West to cross its own red lines, whereas now, finally, we have reached that point where he is asking the West to cross actual, real Russian red lines. And the Pentagon and Western governments are not keen on that idea. They pretended for more than 2.5 years that they're not going to, they pay no attention to Russian red lines. But now that they finally come up against them, they are nervous. We have an article in Politico which says as much. It talks about how exasperated and angry and frustrated the Ukrainians are by the fact that the Western powers are prepared to shoot down Iranian missiles raining down on Israel, but are not prepared to shoot down Russian missiles raining down on Ukraine. But Politico makes the point, and has been told to make that point, has been communicated to it by people inside the US government, as Politico says. Politico makes the point that the fundamental difference is that the Russians have nuclear weapons and the Iranians do not. That might be a difficult thing for the Ukrainians to accept, but it is simply fact. And that, in effect, brings us to all of the various things that Zelensky is asking for. He wants immediate, accelerated entry, or at least an invitation, an accelerated invitation to Ukraine to join NATO. We'll see in a moment that he slightly qualifies that in his actual speech. But he wants accelerated invitation to join NATO. But the Russians have made it absolutely clear that that is a red line. They will not agree to Ukraine joining NATO. They will not respect that decision. The war will continue. And then, of course, the question will be whether the West, if it were to agree to Zelensky's demand, were prepared to fight the Russians under the Article 5 of the Washington Treaty provisions or not. And of course, we know that they are not, and they're not going to risk, or so it seems to me, destroying NATO's credibility by having their bluff on that called. Zelensky clearly, and this is, I think there's been some debate about this, but he is clearly calling for a major military presence by the West, by NATO, on the territory of Ukraine itself. He's very vague as to what exactly it is that he is asking for. And to make matters even more complicated, apparently there are going to be further guarantees and arrangements that he's not prepared to disclose. He's not mentioned in this speech, but apparently he's asking the Western powers to make certain commitments that are going to be kept secret, which, well, one has to wonder what they are, but almost certainly they are of a very, very extreme nature if they have to be kept secret. Anyway, he clearly wants the West to deploy troops to Ukraine, to deploy weapons, its own weapons to Ukraine, to send its own personnel to Ukraine, and to come to all kinds of agreements, reach all kinds of agreements with Ukraine as to the sort of things that it would be prepared to do if the conflict, Ukraine were to find itself attacked by Russia all over again. But of course, again, that is a Russian red line. The Russians have repeatedly made clear that not only is NATO membership for Ukraine a complete non-starter, but the forward positioning of NATO troops and NATO infrastructure in Ukraine is that only even more so. So, and of course, Zelensky continues to insist on Ukraine's right to conduct missile strikes onto Russian territory. And again, the Russians have made it very clear since the summer, repeated statements, including by President Putin himself, that this also is a Russian red line. So what Zelensky is asking the Western powers to do is not to cross their own red lines. They've always shown, up to this time, a readiness to do that. What he is now asking them to do, and for the first time, is to cross Russian red lines, which they have now collided against. And all the indications are that the Pentagon is not willing to do that. Some European governments are, probably, but not the big ones, not the one that really matters, which is the United States. So the White House spokesman has said that the United States has not changed its policy on missile strikes inside Russia. And I noticed that she went on to say something that she hasn't said before, that the United States policy on this issue is not going to change, that there is no intention of changing this policy. And the United States government has gone further and has also said, again, and I believe other governments, other NATO governments have said this as well, that the United States does not regard entry of Ukraine into NATO as appropriate at this time. And as for the forward deployment of NATO infrastructure in Ukraine, well, there's been a stony silence from Western governments above this. But in a sense, the Politico article ruling out US aircraft, Western aircraft and missile systems with Western pilots, Western air forces and Western militaries shooting down missiles over Ukrainian territory. Well, that provides, in effect, its own answer. So this time, I think more likely than not, much more likely than not, Zelensky is going to find that the Western governments, far from acceding to his further demands, are going to be exasperated by those demands and are going to tell him, if only for the first time, that this time he must take no for an answer. Now, saying all of this, everything might change. We don't know what might happen over the next few months. The United States, the administration, massively invested in Ukraine. But over and above and beyond the statements of the United States, the US government that we've just had, we've also had further statements and further moves by the United States, which are also suggesting that they are taking steps basically to rein the Ukrainians in. Firstly, we've now had information about another US military package for Ukraine. It's, I think, about $450 million. It's another tranche of the funds allocated from the $61 billion appropriation voted by Congress in April. I'm going to wait and see what Brian Beletic is going to tell us about the details of this package. But from what I can see, it is simply more provision of the same. It doesn't look as if it is meeting or coming close to meeting any of Zelensky's demands for further escalation. Just saying. And there is another report. In fact, it's more than a report, but it's in the media, which is about the F-16 saga. This has been extraordinary, complicated saga. The Dutch defense minister earlier today came out with incredibly provocative statements, whether he understood fully what he was saying or whether he's again trying to shift the envelope on this, or whether, given that the Dutch government is deeply divided on this whole issue with Geert Wilders' party forming a part of it, whether this is something to do with Dutch internal politics, I don't know. But he's again spoken about how Ukraine is perfectly at liberty to use the Dutch-supplied F-16s to conduct attacks on Russian territory in self-defense. The very thing, of course, that the Russians have categorically ruled out and have said that for them, doing something like that would be a red line. Anyway, that's the Dutch. But perhaps more interesting is what the Americans are apparently now saying. Now, we have reports that around 8 Ukrainian pilots have so far been trained to fly these aircraft. Apparently, it is not, the training program has not gone well. And if you again have been listening to Brian Beletic's programs over several years now, you would be completely unsurprised by this. Training pilots to fly aircraft like the F-16s, aircraft that they're completely unfamiliar with, would be a challenging thing. It would normally take several years. Ryan Baletic has at various times made a further point, which I think bears remembering, which is that regardless of whether or not you're able to train the pilots, integrating completely new military systems like the F-16s into your military, especially if it is a military organized and trained and built up on completely different lines, like the Ukrainian military is a process that in itself normally would be expected to take years. I can't remember the example that he cited, but he's cited one instance when it took around a decade for, I think it was an East European country, to be able to integrate F-16 fighter jets or Western fighter jets into its air force and to start operating them successfully. So expecting that Ukrainian pilots accustomed to flying aircraft like the MiG-29 or the Sukhoi 27 could, after just a few months of training, simply convert to quickly to operating F-16s was always, shall we say, something of a stretch. And it doesn't seem to have happened. On the one occasion when we know an F-16 was deployed to try to shoot down Russian missiles, it crashed. It's not clear how that crash happened. It doesn't seem to have been the result of enemy action. In other words, it doesn't seem to have been shot down by a Russian missile. The suggestions are that the pilot wasn't sufficiently in control of the aircraft. Ukrainian pilot wasn't sufficiently in control of the aircraft, didn't understand how to operate it fully, tried to do things with the aircraft that it wasn't really designed for, causing the crash. That's at least what some of the reports have suggested. Anyway, we haven't heard anything about the F-16 since, except that there are occasional reports and odd claims that the Russians have destroyed warehouses in Starokonstantinov and other places where several F-16s were supposed to be housed. Claims, by the way, which I ought to stress, have been made by various reporting channels and Russian bloggers, but which, to my knowledge, have never been made by the Russian Ministry of Defense. Anyway, we are now told that the United States has become disillusioned with the existing pilot training program for the F-16, and that they've therefore decided that they're going to change the orientation of this training program, and that they're going to try and train pilots who have not previously flown Soviet-era jets of the sort that Ukrainian Air Force was accustomed to use. Apparently 12 pilots have been selected, and that the result is that the date for the proper operation of Ukraine's F-16 squadron, which is set to number around 20 aircraft, has been put back to March 2025. Now, I'm going to say something. I don't know much about who these people who are going to be trained are and whether they've already received training. Maybe there's been quiet training programs training Ukrainian pilots to use F-16s that have already been taking place and started years ago and about which we were never informed. That would not be inconceivable. But if, as some of the reports suggest, these people are being trained now, then frankly, It is inconceivable, I would have thought, on basis of everything I have heard, that Ukraine will be able to operate, that these people will be able to operate F-16s by March of next year. We would be looking at an operational deployment years from now rather than months from now. Anyway, which, by the way, may suggest that, as I said, there's more complicated elements to this story than we know. But anyway, this whole saga of the F-16s it's been a red herring right from the beginning because, as I've discussed in many programs, the F-16 doesn't seem to me, and I've been contacted by many people about this, the F-16 doesn't actually offer a capability which is more advanced than those of the Soviet era fighters, which Ukraine had previously had. There are more sophisticated versions of the F-16s that operate today, but the Dutch aircraft are not amongst the most sophisticated. And yes, they have been upgraded, but not to the level of some of the latest F-16s that are flying. And even if they had been, they would still be outmatched by most of the Russian fighters, which are in the skies anyway in far greater numbers with far more experienced and better trained pilots, just saying. But beyond that, I mean, this whole story of the F-16s has disregarded the difficulty and complexity of integrating fighter jets, Western fighter jets, into the Ukrainian system, which people like Brian Beletic and various officials in the Pentagon and other commentators have for long pointed out. By the time these F-16s fly and start to operate with any degree of effectiveness, it will be far too late. It will be like the German jet fighter developments of the Second World War, which did, by the way, provide an actual important new capability, but which only appeared at the very end of the war when they had come far too late to make a difference. And it seems to me that that is the story with the F-16s. But anyway, going back to my previous point, the fact that the United States is in effect pushing back even notional F-16 deployments to March of next year, I can't help but think that this is a further sign that the United States is pulling back in its investment in Ukraine. It is giving further signals to the Ukrainians that their desire, their stated desire for American intervention, for all of these things that Zelensky is asking for, is unwelcome by the United States and is not going to be provided. Well, that's my view as of today. In a couple of days' time, I think tomorrow, in fact, President Biden arrives in Berlin. He's going to have a meeting with Western leaders. We will see whether that sticks. My own sense on Ukraine is that if you are looking for a loose cannon within the American government, someone who makes a decision and then changes it and who can never be relied upon to stick consistently to a line that he has taken, a red line that he has taken with respect to Ukraine, then that loose cannon is none other than the president himself. He has repeatedly announced red lines, which he has always crossed. He's sense of investment in Project Ukraine is incredibly strong. His visceral feelings about President Putin blind him, I feel, sometimes to the objective realities of the situation. As I said, I would consider him the loose cannon in this story. It's entirely possible that after talking to Scholz, after escaping, if you like, the Washington bubble, he comes to Berlin and changes everything and tells Zelensky, well, it might risk World War III, but in spite of that, I'm going to authorize that you get everything that you're asking for. I don't expect it myself, but, you know, it could happen. One reason why I don't think it is going to happen, and another reason why I think that Project Ukraine is now coming to an end, and why the Western powers must be deeply frustrated and angry about Zelensky, and why they're taking steps to suppress, to the extent that they can, discussion of his speech to the Rada, is the speech itself. Now, Julian Röpke, when he discussed the speech, said that it left him speechless. I have to say, that, for me, was, if anything, an understatement. I know that there is a school of thought. It's been discussed by Diemer at the Military Summary Channel, Simplicius the Thinker in his blog, that this speech is essentially an ultimatum to the West, that Zelensky is saying, unless you give me all of these things, we're not going to be able to go on fighting. We're going to lose the war. And for that reason, and in light of that, if you don't give me all of these things, at some point over the next few weeks and months, I'm going to capitulate, Ukraine will capitulate, and we will surrender to the Russians on their terms. And, you know, if you want to prevent that, you've got to give me all of those things that I am asking for. It ought to be said that there are people in Ukraine itself who think that. Yuri Lutsenko, the former Attorney General of Ukraine, the one who was appointed when his predecessor, Mr. Shokin, was sacked in circumstances I'm not going to discuss in this program, but which Alex Christoforo and I have discussed in many programs on our channel. Anyway, Yuri Lutsenko, he's come along and he's also lent his weight to this theory that this is all been done in preparation for the Western rejection of this bizarre shopping list of demands, which is all that this victory plan is, and that once that rejection has taken place, then Zelensky intends cunningly and why, you know, in to move forward and to tell the Russians and others, well, the West has abandoned us, has abandoned Ukraine. We have no option, therefore, but to capitulate and to negotiate with you on the basis of your demands. Well, I think people who are saying that have not actually listened to or read Zelensky's speech, because I find it completely extraordinary. Now, I'm going to read extracts from it. I'm not going to read the whole speech, even though it is not behind a paywall. You can access it by going, as I said, to his website, President of Ukraine. But it starts with these words, glory to Ukraine. Our people in Ukraine, around the world, never tire of saying glory to Ukraine. Ukraine never tires of responding. Glory to the heroes. But on our land, the words Ukraine must win have become less common. For some, victory has become an uncomfortable word, unfortunately. And in reality, we understand victory is not easy to achieve. But only victories bring glory to a country, and they allow us to preserve the true memory of heroes for centuries to come. And they give the country the ability to live independently, to live freely, sovereignty on its own land and by its own laws, and to choose its own future. The future for Ukraine is without a doubt to be a strong part of the global world, to stand as equals with all leading nations, to be a full-fledged member of the European Union and NATO. It is only fair for us to be there. Glory to Ukraine. Ukrainians deserve this, and this is our goal: to win back Ukraine's right to life, to secure the very justice for Ukraine, to end this war with a reliable and fair peace for all of us. And then he goes on to say later on that Ukraine's plan is a plan to strengthen our country, to strengthen our positions, so that we are strong enough to end the war, so that Ukraine has all the muscles. This plan can be implemented. It depends on our partners. I emphasize on partners. It certainly does not depend on Russia. But we, Ukrainians, together with our partners, must change the circumstances so that the war ends regardless of what we want. And then he talks about how the Russians are not really interested in real diplomacy. He then addresses all the various agencies in the Ukrainian government, and he speaks about the urgency of the victory plan is now. There are points, most of which are thoroughly time-based. If we begin following this idea, the concrete victory plan right now, it may be possible to end the war no later than next year. And then he goes on to say that lots of countries, the Baltic states, Finland, countries that are neighbours, the Baltic countries, countries of Central Asia, Georgia, Moldova, other countries, Libya, Syria, the countries of the Sahel region, they all depend, in effect, on Ukraine winning its victory. And he then talks about how Putin is insane. I mean, he actually uses that word to describe him, and that the war therefore must go on. And then he goes on to say Russia must lose the war against Ukraine, and this is not a freeze. And it is not trading Ukraine's territory or sovereignty. We must implement the victory plan to force Russia to attend the peace summit and be willing to end the war. So the plan consists of 5 points and 3 secret annexes. As I said, we don't know what the secret annexes are. And then he says the first is geopolitical. The second and third points are military. The fourth point is economic. The fifth point is security related. Well, I have to say this. I do not see anything here, anything at all, that suggests to me someone who is preparing to give up, who intends, if his plan is rejected, to sue for peace with Russia. I am unable to find even a glimmer of such a suggestion anywhere in this article, in this speech at all. It seems to me, once again, to have a sort of Manichaean existential quality. Mark Bennett's in the London Times, the only person, in my opinion, who has spoken about this speech with any degree of factual analysis, at least in the West. He's talked about it as being a desperate plea for support. Anyway, he's mentioned its romantic character, which I think is there, as all of us can see. Anyway, I think when Zelensky says that this is a plan for victory, he really believes it. He understands that there is war fatigue in Ukraine. He understands that Ukraine is being ground down. He wants, however, still to achieve his victory. And what he wants is the West to accept his victory plan. And he somehow believes that if that happens, that will be enough by itself to frighten the Russians into capitulation so that they attend the peace summit that he wants to organize and will there accept in full his demands, which are for their unconditional withdrawal from all territory, all pre-2014 Ukrainian territory, including Crimea, and then for negotiations about war crimes trials, Russian leaders, reparations, all of that sort of thing. That, to my mind, is what this victory plan is all about. It's a desperate device to keep the war going. It is not a plan to end the war, to tell the Russians, to tell the West, if you don't give me what I want, I'm going to have to turn to the Russians and surrender. I simply don't see this anywhere. In fact, he goes on to say, tomorrow I will present the victory plan at a meeting of the European Council publicly, but it was very important for me to present it to all of you today. I also want to be frank with you about the about how the situation is being handled today in some non-public, multi-format communications with Ukraine as well. We hear the word negotiations from some of our partners, and the word justice is much less pronounced. That is why we have the peace formula, that's his plan. It is a guarantee of negotiations without forcing Ukraine into injustice. In other words, Russia must capitulate, and only then can there be negotiations, which will be on Ukraine's only terms. And Ukrainians deserve a decent way for peace. The victory plan will be the way for this. The victory plan is a guarantee that the madmen in the Kremlin will lose the ability to continue the war. Ukraine must be strong, united, and conscious that Russia cannot let us go. Russia must permanently lose control over Ukraine, and even the desire for such control. It's a guarantee for peace for all of Europe. And anyway, he goes on in that way. So he's not looking to capitulate. He's not looking to negotiate with the Russians. That is not, his victory plan is not a mechanism to get the Western powers, to get the Western powers to reject it so that he can then go ahead and capitulate in negotiations with the Russians. It's the diametric opposite. It's a call to go on fighting as long as possible, but telling the West, well, we are tired, you are tired. Here is the quick, simple way to end this thing now. Just agree to all of the demands that I'm asking for, and we will have victory immediately. The Russians will capitulate. They will back down. This terrible man, Vladimir Putin, and the other madmen in the Kremlin, they will all be dispersed to the winds, and that which we have, all of us, always wanted will then be achieved. I defy anybody to go through this speech and read it and find anything else than that within it. Anyway, I did say that Zelensky did qualify his demand for entry into NATO by admitting that it could not happen immediately. This is what he said. We are a democratic nation that has proven capable of defending the Euro-Atlantic region and our shared way of life of other democratic nations. For decades, Russia has exploited geopolitical uncertainty in Europe, specifically the fact that Ukraine is not a NATO member. And that is what tempted Russia to encroach on our security. And now the fact that Ukraine is invited to join NATO could become truly fundamental for peace. We understand that NATO membership is a matter for the future, not the present, but Putin must see that his geopolitical calculations are failing. The Russian people must feel this, that their Tsar has lost geopolitically to the world. And the invitation is a powerful decision that requires nothing but determination. So what he's saying is, well, you know, we accept we can't be members of NATO at once, but just invite us to become NATO, members of NATO, to become members of NATO, and that will be enough. The Russians, merely at that word, that fact that Ukraine has been invited to join NATO, that would be sufficient by itself to trigger this capitulation that we are demanding. Now, of course, an invitation couched in that way, an invitation to join NATO, whatever Zelensky may say, can only ultimately have any purpose, any function, if it is really intended as a mechanism for an accelerated entry into NATO. He knows that. The Russians know that. NATO itself knows that. That is the reality of it. Anyway, on the point about a deployment of forces by the West into Ukraine, I know that some people are skeptical about this. But again, look at Zelensky's words. The third point of the victory plan is a point called deterrence. It also has a corresponding secret. Annex: the United States, the leaders of the United Kingdom, France, Italy and Germany have already received it. When Russia knows that the response will come and understands what kind of response it will be, they choose negotiations and stable coexistence, even with strategic adversaries, and deterring Russia from aggression is possible. And then he goes on to say, Ukraine offers to deploy a comprehensive non-nuclear strategic deterrence package on its territory, that it will be sufficient to protect Ukraine from any military threat posed by Russia, and that will limit as much as possible the variability of Russia's actions to such prospects. Well, a comprehensive non-nuclear strategic deterrent package, I would suggest, combined with all kinds of secret annexes, can only mean a deployment of NATO forces, a powerful NATO military force on the territory of Ukraine itself. And I will just finish that in return for all of this, or this package, what Zelensky is going ahead and offering are all of Ukraine's resources. They will be provided to the West, and and of course, Ukraine's military, which will then have been strengthened by the war, that will be provided to the West as well. So that's Zelensky's package. It is not a mechanism intended to get Ukraine into a position where it can negotiate with Russia. It's a last desperate plea. Here I agree completely with Mark Bennett's, to get the West on board so that they can help Ukraine win its war. It's a fantastic plan. It shows the completely delusional nature of Zelensky's government, or at least of Zelensky himself, and of the circle around him. It shows total disregard for the overall realities. The Russians, there's been a sneering response, by the way, to this victory plan from the Russians. The Russian officials have spoken about how Zelensky's plan is basically nothing more than, the Russian foreign ministry spokesman said this is, of course, no plan at all. It is a collection of incoherent slogans. It is blood foam at the mouth of a murderer. That's what she said. One could see all of that. But as I said, anybody who is looking to Zelensky to find some means to negotiate peace with Russia, realistically, is going to be disappointed by this speech. And anybody who thinks that the speech is a pathway to that is, I think, not reading the speech properly. As I said, Mark Bennett spoke about Zelensky's romanticism, that is a kind way of describing it. A desperate plea, I think, is correct. But anyway, one way or the other, it's absolutely clear to me, reading this speech, that he at least, whatever happens, only thinks of fighting on. Now that, lastly, brings me to the actual military situation on the front lines. And I think it's fair to say that the last 24 hours have been actually amongst the most dramatic of the last couple of weeks. Firstly, the Russian Defense Ministry has confirmed that Maximilianovka, a village to the west of Kurakhovo, has fallen fully under Russian control. The Russians now control Gostria, Kurakhovo, Ostrivska, all of the places to the west and north of Kurakhovo along the reservoir. The Ukrainian troops in Kurakhovo are apparently saying that Russian bombing of Kurakhovo has resumed at an extreme tempo, that the Russians are dropping Fab 1500 bombs on them, as well as multiple other types of bombs, that the Russian artillery around Kurakhovo is extremely active. The Ukrainian troops in Kurakhovo are apparently also saying that they expect a Russian attack on them to begin on the 20th of October. And they also say that the Russians have been reorganizing their forces around Kurakhovo and indeed in the entire area of the Pokrovsk-Selidovo Kurakhovo direction, and that reorganization is now completed, and that the Russian offensive will resume with a vengeance, as I said, they expect on the 20th of October. And we now apparently have photographic confirmation of the presence of Russian troops, that the Russians have created a wedge between the villages of Novoselidovka and Izmailovka. This has been discussed many times, but now we have photographic evidence of this. This effectively confirms the existence. This is film, photographic evidence that effectively confirms the existence of the cauldron in the villages of Kurakhovka, Vovchenka, Izmailovka, the town of Girnik, what I've been talking about for a fair amount of time now. We're also getting reports that the situation of the Ukrainian forces in Selidovo is now becoming critical. The security forces, our old friends, the security forces, have told TASS, data recorders show that the enemy is trying to withdraw from Selidovo in small groups. We cannot say that this is a mass phenomenon, but it is not unusual and it is becoming more frequent every day. The operational situation for the Ukrainian armed forces in the city is deteriorating. In fact, just a little more and the Ukrainian military will be again forced to make a difficult decision, either to sacrifice most of its manpower in Selidovo, just like in Ugledar, or to withdraw the entire group. And this follows on reports that the Russians have been advancing along the railway lines to this village of Vishnevka, west of Selidovo, and also advancing to cut off the road from Selidovo to Pokrovsk, that Selidovo, in effect, already perhaps in operational encirclement, is about to be brought under a full siege, that a cauldron for the Ukrainian troops is about to be established there. And further east, there's been more reports of further Russian advances in Toretsk, which I'm going to skip because we're hearing a lot about that recently, but it looks as if the Russians are steadily advancing through Toretsk. And I'm going to say straightforwardly, I think the maps that people are producing of who controls what in Toretsk are completely out of date. I suspect, based on Russian reports, I'm talking about TASS reports, the Russians probably control pretty much most of Toretsk now, and that the Ukrainians indeed only occupy or are secure control of only a number of places on the western outskirts. There may be Ukrainian troops deeper inside Toretsk, but I suspect that they're effectively surrounded. Just saying. And if we discuss the situation elsewhere on the battlefronts, there are also reports now from Chasiv Yar that the Russian pincers are closing around Chasiv Yar, that the Russians are continuing their advance in southern Chasiv Yar, and it again looks as if an offensive in Chasiv Yar is about to start. Again, it's being suggested that the 20th of October may be the day. But in some respects, the most interesting news is coming from Siversk. Now, yesterday I said that film had appeared, which appeared to show fighting in Verkhokamyanska, the village to the west of Siversk, which the Russian Defense Ministry about 2 weeks ago said had fallen under Russian control. There's a lot of people who disputed that this was so, including, I remember, Rybar. Yesterday, the fact that there were pictures of drone attacks by the Russians on what looked like Ukrainian troops in Verkhokamyanska was seen as proof by many people, and I accepted it in my video yesterday, that previous Russian Defense Ministry report was untrue. I speculated that maybe the Russian Defense Ministry or someone in the Russian Defense Ministry had confused Verkhokamyanska with another village further to the east, Verkhokamyanka, which the Russians indisputably do control. Well, it looks as if the earlier reports, the reports of the Russian Defense Ministry, were correct after all. We now have apparently confirmation that the Russians have captured, over the last couple of hours, a major hill position immediately to the north of Verkhokamyanska. This is apparently the dominating height in the region. And when I say we got confirmation of this, there's film evidence showing this, apparently. It seems to me that the most likely explanation is that there's been intense fighting, both for Velikokamianska itself and for this hill. The Russians probably captured the village at the beginning of this month. Then they moved on to capture the hill to the north of it. The Ukrainians counterattacked. The fighting, the pictures of the fighting in the village that we saw yesterday were the Russians repelling the Ukrainian counterattack. The hill is now securely under Russian control. That means apparently that the village will be very soon, and many are speaking about this being a dramatic development that will in effect begin to close the whole chapter of Siversk. And there are also reports, more reports, of further Russian advances still further north around Kupiansk. I discussed that all in great detail in my program yesterday. And that there have been more Russian advances in the Kursk pocket, that Ukrainian troops in the area of Malaya Lochnya have now been surrounded. Again, there's no actual confirmation of this, but these reports are circulating. Maybe they are true. But anyway, one way or the other, the progress towards Russian victory continues. And, well, as Yurian Repke said, whatever you may think, whatever your views about Zelensky's victory plan, as he outlined it to the Rada, well, it offers no solution to the existing problems that the Ukrainian army is suffering. My own view, straightforwardly, is that what Zelensky is basically saying is that we must fight on. If the West wants us to win our victory this year or early next year, my victory plan lays out how it can be done, which is absurd, by the way. But anyway, that's what he's saying. But regardless of that, whether the West wants us to win soon, whether people in Ukraine themselves are tired, we must go on fighting, because unless we do, our glory as a nation, our justice as a nation, our existence as a nation will be lost. We will again be submerged in the Russian world, which is something we must at all costs fight to prevent. And if we lose, let us at least go down heroically, because submission to that kind of defeat is unacceptable to us. It's, in other words, as far as I can see, a formula for fighting to the end, a complete rejection of any idea of capitulation. It's not that different in the end from the sort of thinking that the German leaders had in the Second World War. Anyway, that's where I end my program today. I'm going to probably return once more, I suspect, to the situation in the Middle East and the Ukraine tomorrow. It seems to me that we're now on the brink of something big in the Middle East. And as for the war in Ukraine, I suspect it will grind on. I suspect that the West will indeed continue to walk away, and that in the end, it will end in a Russian victory, a complete Russian victory, with all the problems for the Russians and the Europeans that will lead to, because no one in the West and in Ukraine has the courage, the imagination, the realism to do what is necessary to avoid it. Just as the war was always avoidable, in my opinion, so is the coming defeat. But I have all but given up thinking that it can be prevented. Just to remind you again, you can find all our programs on Locals, Rumble and X. You can support our work via Patreon and Subscribestar links under this video. Don't forget also to check out our shop. And last but not least, if you've liked this program, please remember to tick the like button and to check your subscription to this channel.